Okay, welcome back. The last speaker in this session is Sergey Bravyi from IBM, and he's going to talk about improved classical simulation of quantum circuits.
Okay, thanks. Yes, the topic of my talk will be classical simulation of quantum circuits, and this is a joint work with David Gossett. And I believe most of us believe that quantum circuits are hard to simulate classically. In particular, all simulation algorithms that we currently know, including the one that I will present, run in exponential time, at least in the worst case. Of course, we cannot rule out possibility that perhaps there is some more clever algorithm that runs in sub-exponential time. And this motivates the search for new algorithmic tools to simulate quantum circuits. And I'm going to present you some examples of such tools and demonstrate how they work in practice. Okay, so let's begin. We shall only consider Clifford+T circuits that are defined here. So we have n qubits initialized in zero state. And then we apply some sequence of gates that belong to this Clifford+T gate set defined here. And finally, we measure some subset of qubits in computational basis. So these Clifford+T circuits have some nice properties. First of all, they are universal, so we can express any quantum algorithm. Secondly, we have certain nice algebraic structure that enables efficient gate synthesis. We know how to implement these gates fault-tolerantly on logical qubits that are encoded, for example, by surface code. So this is a natural gate set for a fault-tolerant quantum computer. So suppose we take some Clifford+T circuit and we count how many T gates we have. And this number is usually called the T count. So in this example, T count equals 3. And our result is a classical simulation algorithm for Clifford+T circuits with a small T count. And by small, I mean something like 50 or maybe 100. So the circuit must be dominated by Clifford gates. So why is this interesting? As I said, if we talk about logical qubits and encoded gates, then logical T gates are very expensive, at least in the surface code architecture. So we expect that first demonstrations of logical circuits will be those dominated by Clifford gates. And our algorithm could serve as verification tool for such early quantum circuits. And it also gives us more insights on conditions for this quantum supremacy. We can understand better which quantum circuits are hard and which are easier to simulate. The runtime of our algorithm depends only on a few parameters defined here. We have number of qubits n, number of Clifford gates c, and T count t. The most popular classical simulation algorithm is what I call a universal simulator. And it means that at each time step in the circuit, we represent our n qubit state by a complex vector of size 2 to the n. And each time we apply a gate, we update this vector by applying some sparse matrix. And there are several efficient implementations of this algorithm, for example, Microsoft Liquid and others. The runtime of such universal simulators always scales exponentially with the number of qubits, just because of memory requirement, and it scales linearly with the total number of gates. And this exponential scaling limits it to a small number of qubits, perhaps 40 or maybe 42. But advantage of this algorithm is it can simulate essentially any gate set. In fact, even non-unitary gate set. There is another class of simulators, what I call stabilizer simulators. They can simulate circuits with maybe 100 or even 1,000 of qubits, but these circuits must be composed of only Clifford gates. And these simulators use this Gottesman-Knill theorem to do simulation. And there are some generalizations of these stabilizer simulators that can handle a few T gates. This is not too important, but the idea is to somehow decompose your computational state into some simpler states, such as stabilizer states. And the runtime of stabilizer simulators typically scales exponentially with the number of T gates. So it's limited to a small T count. And what we try to understand is basically what is the coefficient in the exponent and what T counts can we simulate in practice, and yes, how practical is this? So now let me state our results. And the first simulation task that I consider is what I call strong simulation. So we have our Clifford+T circuit, and it has some designated output register of W qubits. And we measure each output qubit. We get some string of measurement outcomes X. And this, this string comes from some probability distribution P out. What we want to do is to approximate probability of some particular measurement outcome X within a specified relative error epsilon. So this is a strong simulation task. We proposed an algorithm, that classical algorithm for this task, and the runtime of this algorithm is shown here. So it has two terms. The first term is some degree three polynomial that you would expect to get from Gottesman-Knill theorem. And the more interesting term is the second one. So you can see that it scales exponentially with the T count polynomially with other parameters. of course, with a strong simulation, our task is unreasonably hard, because even a quantum computer would not be able to approximate these outward probabilities. So for one hand, a quantum computer can only sample from the output distribution, and if we take into account errors and fault tolerance, we always introduce some additive error rather than multiplicative error. So this strong simulation is too hard, and why should we try to solve it in the first place? A slightly more reasonable task is what I call weak simulation. Here, the task is to sample the output string from some distribution which is epsilon close to the ideal output distribution of the circuit. To state our result, let me define this parameter W, and this is just the number of qubits that we are going to measure at the end. We propose classical algorithm for this weak simulation, and the runtime of the algorithm is shown here. Again, there is this uninteresting polynomial term, and there is exponential scaling with the T count. But the coefficient in the exponent is much better. So this is roughly square root speed up compared with strong simulation. Now, you may say that we have these polynomial factors that are not too great. So is this practical? To answer this, we just implemented the algorithm in MATLAB, and these are typical parameters of circuits that we can simulate on a laptop computer in a few hours. So about 50 qubits, about 50 T gates, 1,000 Clifford gates. So these are pretty big circuits. So let me mention that these are only upper bounds on the runtime of the algorithm in the worst case. And we don't know whether these upper bounds are tight. Quite recently, we managed to improve these polynomial factors a little bit. This is unpublished result, and I'm not going to talk about this. In the rest of the talk, I will try to sketch how our simulation algorithm works. And it has several ingredients, so magic states and gadgetized circuits. I will talk about magic states and the stabilizer rank. And the last ingredient is a fast norm estimation algorithm. Let me first remind you what are magic states. So these are single qubit states that sit on the equator of the Bloch sphere, right in the middle between x and y axis. And the reason why these magic states are important is because we can implement a T-gate using this simple gadget. It consumes one copy of the magic state, performs some Clifford operations like C0, measurement, control, classically controlled S-gate. So this gadget implements T-gate. Both measurement outcomes here appear with probability 1/2. I'm going to use a post-selected version of this T-gate gadget. This zero box means that we take a T-gate gadget and we post-select measurement outcome zero. And one box means that we post-select measurement outcome one and we apply S-gate. So both zero and one boxes implement ideal T-gate up to this normalization factor. Suppose this is our Clifford+T circuit that I want to simulate. What we are going to do is to replace each T-gate in the circuit by this post-selected T-gadget. For each gadget, I can post-select measurement outcome zero or one. And I denote this post-selection bits Y. Okay. By construction, this post-selected circuit simulates the original circuit exactly for any choice of these post-selection bits. Now, what I'm going to do next is to, instead of preparing magic states inside of each gadget, I can prepare all magic states in advance at the very first time step. And likewise, instead of post-selecting measurement outcomes inside each gadget, I can postpone post-selections until the very last time step. And if I do this, I get equivalent gadgetized circuits. So now it contains only Clifford gates, but it acts on this initial state that contains T copies of the magic state. roughly speaking, we pushed all non-Cliffordness into the initial state of the circuit. And now we have only Clifford gates. To get a good simulation algorithm, I'm going to approximate this initial magic state by some simpler state. Let's call it psi. So I will have some error epsilon in the initial state of the circuit. What we would like to prove is that this small initial error translates to small error in the final state produced by the circuit. This is no longer unitary circuit because we include post-selection. We cannot prove that the output error is small for all possible post-selection strings. And probably this is not even true. But what we can prove is the following. So basically, this lemma says that if we pick post-selection string Y at random from the uniform distribution, then on average, a small input error translates to a small output error. this is the first result. What does this lemma says? That we can reduce weak simulation of Clifford+T circuits to strong simulation of random post-selective Clifford circuits. And these post-selective circuits act on initial state which is a good approximation to tensor product of magic states. And I'm going to choose this approximation psi as a linear combination of a small number of stabilizer states. And this will allow me to accomplish this simulation using Gottesman-Knill theorem. So this is the plan. So now let's talk about stabilizer rank. So just to remind you that so stabilizers, n-qubit stabilizer states are defined as shown here. So we take O0 state and we apply arbitrary Clifford circuit. So what we get is n-qubit stabilizer state. Say for one qubit we have six stabilizer states that are eigenvectors of Pauli operators. For two qubits we have tensor product stabilizer states and some entangled states. Say we take this EPR state and apply a Clifford operator to one of the qubits. In general, for n qubits, we have some set S sub n of stabilizer states, and the size of this set grows very rapidly as you increase number of qubits. So it's exponential in n squared. suppose you give me some n qubit state psi, then I define stabilizer rank of psi as the smallest integer chi, such that psi can be written as a linear combination of chi stabilizer states. We can also define approximate stabilizer rank. And here, instead of exact representation, I just want to get epsilon approximation to psi. So this is a definition of a stabilizer rank. As an example, let's compute stabilizer rank of these magic states. So if we have just one qubit, the magic state is a sum of two stabilizer states, 0 and 1, and it's not stabilizer state itself, so its stabilizer rank equals 2. Now, for two qubits, things are slightly more interesting. So if you take two copies of the magic state, expand it in the standard basis and group the terms as shown here, you can recognize that each term is a two-qubit stabilizer state. So we know that its stabilizer rank is at most 2, and one can show that it's equal to 2. For small number of qubits, we computed upper bounds on stabilizer rank of magic states numerically in this recent paper with Graham Smith and John Smolin. What is surprising here is that as you increase the number of qubits, the stabilizer rank grows sufficiently slower. So this suggests that it grows linearly. But of course, why should we care about this? The reason is that the scaling of this stabilizer rank determines runtime of classical simulation algorithms for Clifford+T circuits. Remember that we have two simulation tasks. For strong simulation, we want to approximate individual output probabilities, and for weak simulation, we want to sample from the output distribution. And if you ignore all polynomial factors, then exact stabilizer rank determines the runtime of a strong simulator, and approximate stabilizer rank determines the runtime of weak simulators. In particular, if someone can prove sub-exponential upper bounds on the stabilizer rank, then this would imply, this would have very strong implications, such as sub-exponential classical simulator for constant depth Clifford+T circuits. So what bounds do we have? Let me consider exact stabilizer rank. The best upper bound that we have is shown here. The proof is just two lines. So we take our n copies of matrix states and divide them into blocks with 6 qubits in each block. Now, for each block, we have this numerically computed upper bound on stabilizer rank, and then we can just use this simple multiplicativity property. Now, in the approximate case, situation is slightly better. So this is our new upper bound. So again, it scales exponentially with the number of qubits, but the exponent is roughly, this is roughly square root improvement compared with the exact case. And let me briefly sketch the proof of this. let me define this single qubit operator R. This is not Clifford operator. In fact, it's not even unitary. But it has a nice property that it maps basis vectors 0 and 1 to stabilizer states. And I'm going to approximate our magic state by these subset states. So we pick some subset of binary strings M. We take uniform superposition of all strings in this subset. And then we apply bitwise R. OK, so this is my subset state. And the first observation is that stabilizer rank of this state is at most the size of M, because each term in this sum is a stabilizer state. And to give you intuition why we choose this definition, let's consider some simple cases. For example, suppose first that M includes all n bit strings. Then one can easily check that this subset state is exactly n copies of the magic state. In the opposite case, if M is just a single bit string, then of course this is a very bad approximation and the overlap is exponentially small. But we can show that in fact this subset state achieves the best overlap with magic state among all possible stabilizer states. So basically, all states in this sum achieve the best overlap with magic state among all stabilizer states. what happens in the intermediate case, what we can show is the following. So suppose we choose this M as a random linear subspace with some fixed dimension K. Then if K is large enough so that we have this bound, then subset state approximates A tensor N with error epsilon with high probability over the choice of M. And because stabilizer rank of the subset state is just the size of M, we get this upper bound that I claimed. Okay. And the last ingredient is this norm estimation algorithm. Before explaining to you what is norm estimation, let me explain why do we need it and what it's supposed to achieve. Remember that we have reduced weak simulation of Clifford+T circuits to a strong simulation of random post-selected Clifford circuits that act on initial states that approximates magic states. And I'm going to choose this approximation as the subset state that I have just defined. So the quantity that we want to compute is this output probability P out, and it depends on some output string X and a post-selection string Y. So we take this initial state, zero qubits, and our subset state. We apply some Clifford unitary circuit. Then we post-select X on the output register, and we post-select Y on a measurement qubit in each gadget. And our goal is to compute this output probability with small relative error. Our algorithm includes a simple preprocessing step based on Gottesman-Knill theorem. And what this preprocessing achieves, it eliminates all qubits initialized in zero state, and it slightly simplifies this Clifford circuit. So after this preprocessing, we can rewrite the output probability as our subset state acted upon by some post-selective Clifford circuit P. And in fact, this circuit P is a product of projectors, pairwise commuting projectors, but that's not too important. So what we want to compute is the norm of this state. yes, and because this post-processing uses standard stabilizer formalism, it can be done in polynomial time. Now, let's look at this state under the norm. As I showed you, this subset state is a sum of that many stabilizer states. And because P is a Clifford circuit, it maps stabilizer states to stabilizer states. So this state under the norm is a sum of roughly this number of stabilizer states. And we want some norm estimation algorithm for states represented as a linear combination of many stabilizer states. Let me sketch how it works. And first of all, let me remind you somehow what manipulations with stabilizer states we can do efficiently. So first of all, we can compute inner products between stabilizer states. And this inner product always has this nice form. P and M are some integers. And we can compute inner product in time roughly n cubed. We can compute what happens if we take a stabilizer state and apply some Pauli measurement. This gives another stabilizer state, and we can compute it in time roughly n squared. And also, we can generate a random stabilizer state drawn from the uniform distribution, it takes time n squared. And so this inner product and Pauli measurements algorithms are very well known. And this random state generation is probably mu. I'm not sure of it. OK, and now let me define this norm estimation. We are given some n-qubit state represented as linear combination of chi stabilizer states. And we need to estimate the norm of this state with some specified relative error. Our algorithm does that, and the runtime is shown here. What is important is that the runtime scales linearly with the number of stabilizer states chi. If you look at the brute force algorithm, we just expand norm square as a sum of chi squared inner products, then the runtime of brute force algorithm would be proportional to chi squared. In our simulation problems, chi is the biggest parameter because it scales exponentially with the T count. So this fast norm estimation gives you roughly square root speed up. Let me sketch how it works. So let phi be our target state. The key idea is to estimate norm of chi by computing inner products between chi and random stabilizer states. So let me define this random variable xi. It's inner product between our target state and a random uniformly distributed stabilizer state. One can easily compute the first two moments of chi. This calculation uses the fact that stabilizer states are two design. So we can compute the first two moments by pretending that this psi is a hard distributed random state. So it tells us that this random variable Xi is unbiased estimator of the norm that gives you a constant relative error. And this is important because we get a good approximation even if the norm of phi is exponentially small. Now, how difficult is to compute Xi? Well, we just expand this inner product, and we get a sum of chi inner products between stabilizer states. So we can compute it in time roughly chi n cube. This gives us unbiased estimator with a constant relative error. So what happens if we want some small relative error delta? Well, we just use Monte Carlo algorithm. And if we generate k-independent samples of Xi, compute the average, then by standard Chebyshev inequality, we get relative error delta, provided that k scales as 1 over delta squared. So the overall running time of this norm estimation algorithm is as shown here. So what's important is that it's only linear in chi. So now let me put everything together. So we want to compute this output probability for some output string X and some post-selection string Y. So this is the sketch of the overall algorithm. So first we use norm estimation algorithm to reduce this norm estimation to computing inner product. So we have this Clifford circuit P, and it's sandwiched between some random stabilizer states phi and this subset state psi m. Then we use Pauli measurement subroutine to somehow we can apply this Clifford circuit P to this stabilizer state phi. We get some new stabilizer state phi prime that we can efficiently compute. And then at the last step, we compute inner product between phi prime and our subset state psi m. And this involves roughly that number of inner product calculations. So computing inner products between stabilizer states is by far the most time-consuming step in our simulation algorithm. let me describe somehow implementation of this algorithm. And first of all, we need to decide what quantum circuits we want to simulate. we decided to choose benchmark circuits that produce deterministic output. So the output state must be a basis vector. the reason for that is that we can compute these output states by applying our simulation algorithm with output register of size 1. So we can learn individual bits of this final state by running a simulation algorithm n times with output register 1. And this eliminates this huge polynomial factor in the runtime of our algorithm. Secondly, we want to have reasonably small T count, simply because the runtime of the algorithm is exponential in T count. And we want to have a large number of qubits so that this simulation cannot be accomplished by, or difficult to accomplish by traditional universal simulator. And it turns out that there is a meaningful class of such quantum circuits, and they implement this hidden shift quantum algorithm for band functions. And it was actually proposed by a chair of this session. So let me briefly sketch what is the algorithm. So we are given some Boolean function f. And just to remind you that f is a band function if both f and Hadamard transform of f takes values plus minus 1. And suppose we have some hidden shift string S. And our goal is to learn S by making queries to certain oracles. And we have one oracle that computes with function F, and another oracle that computes a shifted version of F. In fact, you may notice this hat here. It means that it's a shifted version of Fourier transform of F, but that's not too important. So we are promised that F is a band function, and the goal is to find hidden shift by making as few queries to oracles as possible. And there is a very simple quantum algorithm. So it makes two queries to oracles, and there are some Hadamard gates. Any classical algorithm must make a linear number of queries. this is just an illustration. Here we have 8 qubits, and this is a circuit that implements this hidden shift algorithm. You can see that there is maybe you cannot see this, but there is two subcircuits that implements the oracle for F and the shifted version of this oracle. And we have these three layers of Hadamard gates separating them. Now we use this gadget that implements control-control-Z gate by Jones. So it includes 4 T gates. And so then we can apply our simulation algorithm to simulate circuits of this type. So these are numerical results. So the horizontal axis shows you what is the actual hidden shift string S. And vertical axis shows you probabilities computed by our simulation algorithm. For example, if you look at this column, the actual hidden shift is 1. And our algorithm thinks that probably it's 1 with probability roughly 90%. So you can see that there is a good agreement between algorithm output and the actual hidden shift string. So here in this example, we have 40 qubits and 40 T gates and about 1,000 of Clifford gates. So this is similar simulation, but now we have a little bit about 50 T gates. So you can see that now the precision of simulation is slightly worse, but it's still there is strong correlation between algorithm output and the actual hidden shift string. this is my last slide. I showed you some new algorithmic tools for simulation of quantum circuits, namely quantum circuits that are dominated by Clifford gates. So we proposed these random gadgetized circuits, low-rank stabilizer decompositions of magic states, and fast norm estimation algorithm. And I think somehow the main message of this talk is that if you want to achieve this quantum supremacy regime, so our quantum circuit cannot be simulated classically, then it's not sufficient to have just many qubits. You also need to have sufficiently many T gates, perhaps 100 or a few hundred. I guess this is a bad news, because if you think about logical circuits, then, as I said, T gates are very expensive, and achieving this regime on a fault-tolerant quantum computer might be very hard. Okay, thank you.
Thank you. We have time for a couple of questions. Let's start here in the middle.
Hi, so when you showed that slide with the using numerical simulations to find the stabilizer rank of magic states as a function of n, you showed that up to 7, it looks roughly linear. So is it harder beyond 7, or do you know that beyond 7 it's definitely not linear?
Could you repeat the question?
Like you showed in the slide the relationship between stabilizer rank of the number of magic states as a function of qubits.
Mm-hmm.
And it was linear for most of it.
Oh,
but
yeah,
you expect it to be not linear for beyond 7?
Yes, that's a good question. So unfortunately, we can compute this stabilizer rank numerically only for very small number of qubits. And my expectation is that if you go to more qubits, it would you would see some kind of crossover from linear scaling to exponential scaling, or perhaps some mildly sub-exponential scaling. I'm not sure. But because the set of stabilizer states on n qubits is so enormously large, it's very hard to do this numerical optimization efficiently. So 6 qubits is basically as far as we can go.
So my question is also about this number of this stabilizer rank of t states. So is there a relation between this problem and like optimal circuit compilation using Clifford+T gates? And is there like number field theory techniques that can come in?
Yes, so we can certainly get lower bound on exponential lower bound on stabilizer rank if we assume that Clifford+T circuits are hard to simulate classically in some sense. But we cannot prove any unconditional. Well, we can prove some unconditional lower bounds, but we are very weak. So in the exact case, we can prove lower bound square root of n for n qubit magic states. In the approximate case, we can prove exponential lower bound, but on the assumption that all stabilizer states in the decomposition are orthogonal.
Okay, thank you.
So I was wondering, so Clifford+T is a popular gate set for lots of reasons, but here, do you have any sense that the simulation via magic states for T gates is kind of the best, gives you the best scaling? Or could it be that some other non-Clifford gate, even a multi-qubit gate, might give you better scaling in your simulation than T?
Yes, so for example, if you give me a circuit that uses Clifford gates and say Toffoli gates, then like one option would be to decompose Toffoli's and to T gates and then apply our algorithm. But I think you suggest that maybe we can find some analog of magic state directly for Toffoli gate and decompose it into stabilizer states. We thought about this very briefly, but we have not made much progress. So I don't know what's the answer.
All right, let's take a question from over there.
So the magic state story changes a bit when you go to qdits above just qubits. I was wondering if you've looked at that and whether or not you think the challenge for demonstrating quantum supremacy might be easier or harder in terms of depth of non-Clifford gates when you use qdits.
Yes, so that's a good question. So I think for high-dimensional qubits, finding this low-rank stabilizer decompositions of magic states might be even harder to do. But once you find a good decomposition, it might be plausible that you will get a very good simulation algorithm. But well, the short answer is that we have not looked at what happens with qubits.
Sorry, the short answer is what? Can you say that again?
We don't know what happens with high-dimensional qubits. We only looked at the case of qubits.
Okay.
Thanks.
All right, any more questions? We can take one more question, I think, over there.
So here you're trying to simulate ideal circuits. Have you thought about simulating, say, noisy circuits and the T magic state slowly moving towards the stabilizer polytope? Is there like some kind of threshold where it's efficiently simulatable, and then after it moves out of the stabilizer polytope, it starts becoming difficult?
So if you consider noisy case, then say our initial state is a tensor product of noisy magic states. I think you can use similar tricks and try to decompose it into maybe a probabilistic mixture of stabilizer states, or you could also try to decompose it into a probabilistic mixture of low-rank stabilizer states, and this would give you also a simulation algorithm. So this is a very good question, but we have not tried to do that.
Okay, so let's thank Sergey.
Thank you.
Let's thank all the speakers of this session.